Howdy, folks, and welcome in on an episode where I talk with founder and CEO Kyle Dirksen about the recent launch of the One Wheel S Series. Super exciting new performance-oriented One Wheel that we just released. So I hope you enjoy.
Sure, you have these specs in an engineering sense, but like, what does that really mean for riding, right? You now have like a inverted gravity sport where you get to like do gravity sport stuff going uphill, which is just pretty sweet. So it's pretty cool being able to like basically replay a ride, not just in terms of where they went, but like exactly like how fast was the motor turning and like what were all these parameters and the controller doing at that particular time. And
Kyle, what's going on, man?
Here we are.
Hey, we're back. Yeah. Got a new board here sitting next to us for those of you listening.
Redecorated the studio.
It is right there. The new One Wheel GT S Series. What does the S stand for?
I don't know. We're, you know, taking submissions for what S Series stands for.
It means something different to everybody. But we'll never tell.
We all have something in our minds.
yeah, super exciting. So new board. The best board dropped last Friday. People, you know, we're recording this on Tuesday. People are getting their boards today.
First people getting them today, yep.
That's pretty major. Zero wait time for this thing, which is pretty incredible. Nice job, team. Super exciting to see the first board show up and the reactions soon to come. Where do you want to start? Should we talk about why we made this thing?
Totally.
What makes it cool?
Yeah, why we made this thing? Well, we made this thing originally actually to be a race for the rail board. We were like, oh, wouldn't it be cool if we had special boards for race to the rail? And then we said, well, what would those boards need to have? Well, they would need to go fast. They would need to have sweet tires for the train that is countered on Race for the Rail trails. We need to have excellent ride dynamics, comfort, control, and push the limits of what's possible. So we started tinkering as sort of a side project, which is how One Wheel began, tinkering as a side project.
Right.
That's where the good stuff always comes
from.
All
good things.
Tinkering as a side project, kind of exploring like what some of the new technology advancements might let us do, and did some stuff with firmware at first, and then, you know, started messing around with higher voltage powertrain options and seeing if that was even feasible, and, you know, got those prototypes going, and took them for a few rips, and then it all got a little exciting and said, hey, this should be a actual product. So that's the last few months have been full of.
Messing around with high voltage powertrains is a great
It's what
casual,
we do here.
Casual way to put that.
If that's what you want to do, you know, we're hiring. You know, we need engineers come work with us.
Yeah,
yeah, I mean, it's cool because I think, you know, a lot of what we've tried to do is figure out how to take technology that is basically, you know, like right here in front of us and use that. And this was a bit more like, let's push the technology. You know, e-bikes and stuff like that, they have 36, 48, maybe up to 72 volt powertrains, you know, but going beyond 100 volts in this kind of PEV is pretty rare. And so we had to figure out how to do that. And so, you know, everything's different. The controller's different. The battery module's different. The chargers are different. Mm-hmm. The motor's different to support that. So, you know, what began as just like a little tuning here and there became like fully redesigning the thing.
Right. I know nothing about volts. I don't really know very much about electricity, but I, you know, I've obviously ridden this and you can feel it, but what does the volts allow you to do?
Well, if you decide to go back to college and study engineering this time,
I would say highly unlikely.
Usually in your like intro to, you know, electronics class, they say that, you know, if you imagine like water in a dam or something like that, mm-hmm. like voltage is how high the dam is, and current is how big the pipe is. Mm. So if you want it to, you know, have maximum, you need a giant pipe. That means you need a lot of current and you need it to be really high, which means a lot of voltage.
Right. So it's like potential.
It's exactly.
Right.
Voltage potential. You're ready.
Heck yeah.
You took an elective in engineering.
I did not. I did not.
No, I know.
political science. We can talk about political science.
That'll be a different podcast. But, so 113 volt, particularly why more voltage is better for PEVs. Not all of them. Like an e-bike. Sure.
You don't need it.
You do all the e-bikey things you need with 48 volts for sure. No worries. But mm-hmm. with what we're doing, we're running at higher speeds or higher rotational speeds because the tire is small. And what happens is the faster a DC motor turns, it creates voltage that basically fights against the voltage that you're driving it with. It's called back EMF. And so at some point the back EMF equals your supply voltage and it can't go any faster. So that's the point at which the motor, is going as fast as it can. It's like the free wheel speed, basically. So more voltage increases your free wheel speed. But what increasing the free wheel speed also does is it creates a lot more torque at high speeds, call it medium to high speeds. And so that's what we get here. A lot more torque at medium to high speeds, which makes a huge difference because we're also self-balancing. So you have more stability at medium to high speeds, and you can actually accelerate at medium to high speeds, and you have torque to like go up hills or accelerate up hills at medium to high speeds.
It's incredible.
Kind of a game changer.
It's flat out incredible from what we've had before.
So, the big jump there in voltage unlocks all that.
It is so epic just from the riding side. And, we can jump to some questions later throughout just a little Instagram story to prompt some questions. But one thing that we've already heard a lot of is like, I'm a 200 plus pound rider. Like, what does this mean for me? I'm a 200 plus pound rider. And it's like, I won't swear on the podcast, but it's un-bleeping believable. Like, it's like, I feel like what it's felt to probably be a 130 pound rider going up these hills.
The heavier the rider is, the more torque you need.
Right.
And so to have more torque at speed means that, the heavier rider is, more comfortable at speed. They can climb hills more at speed.
Yeah.
And it just feels good. You also get stronger braking, which is pretty sweet.
Notice that too. Yeah. And I think jumping around a little bit, like I think the other thing that you notice right away, in addition to that, like sort of second acceleration, where you have room for another is just like the level of confidence that you feel at every speed. Of course, this has a top speed of 25 miles an hour, which means you can go faster. Some people ask, when is fast enough?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's the speed thing is interesting, right? Because like if you have never touch pushback on one of our other boards, then you probably don't need S series, but
right.
a lot of our riders, do spend time, where they're getting to push back. And so this moves that up about 5 miles an hour from GT, a little more compared to the other boards, which is like a pretty significant amount of where you want to be riding, like riding at 22, 23 comfortably. Pretty nice for most folks.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I was actually going to push back a little bit, pun intended, on what you said, because I'm someone who never feels the need to give to push back on the GT. My happy zone is like 14, 15, 16, 17. If I'm really pushing it, but on this thing, I'll look down and I'm going like 21, 22. And I think I'm going 16. 17, because it just feels so powerful at that speed. I think
it's good stuff.
It's great stuff. It's really good stuff. Yeah, it's like it's just a rush and it's just a breath of fresh air. And it's a big smile generator. Big smile generator. Let's go back to some of the development story stuff though. So as you mentioned, I think we talked about this already, but maybe not. this started with trying to create a race board. So we had people out, Neil Bennett, one of them, Tyler, obviously here, and put data logging devices in those boards and sent them up into the Santa Cruz Mountains and basically broke down how they're riding the boards. You know, we were telling them, okay, ride like you're in a race. Go as fast as you can. Mm-hmm. Be as demanding as possible. What do we see from that data? What does that like look like?
Yeah, I mean, it looks like a bunch of squiggles on your screen. Mm. But what it tells you is, you know, kind of like in at what periods of time, you know, do they require how much power, and, you know, how many times during a ride are they actually maxing it out?
Right.
You know, and you can kind of put that on another curve that's like how much, basically how much power for what duration and at what speed. Mm. And so that's what we spent a lot of time looking at and just understanding whether, you know, we could modify the existing firmware in GT to, you know, apply more power, or if we actually needed to upgrade the drivetrain so that it could produce more power in, mm-hmm. in those zones. And that's basically how we decided that we needed to, you know, overhaul the drivetrain in order to actually do that. So it's pretty cool being able to, like, basically replay a ride, not just in terms of where they went, but like exactly like how fast was the motor turning and like what were all these parameters in the controller doing at that particular time. And, you know, the phase currents and the bus currents and the, you know, the pack voltage and all the accelerometers and all the filters and all the good stuff in there. So we were looking at all that.
As one does.
Yeah.
My favorite story from the, that testing process started 6+ months ago were some of those first like data logging missions, with those folks. I dropped them off, you know, luckily we're here in Santa Cruz. We can drive up, you know, the Santa Cruz mountain range. We do like what's called a full drop is what we call it. Drop them off on the top of the mountain and they ride down some of the best mountain biking trails to the bottom. I go over and pick them up at Costco, which is on the other side of the mountains. Or they ride home, you know, either way. And we did that a gazillion times. But at some point in the process, we realized that with the uphill capability on this thing, I just started dropping them off at the bottom of the hill over at Costco. And they'd ride up over the peak and then down back to the office. And that was kind of the moment where, you know, they knew they were on something different. I mean, that was definitely a moment where they knew they were on something different. Talking to Neil and Tyler, they were like, we were literally racing.
We didn't tell them what exactly they were riding.
Right.
Like in terms of hardware, firmware, whatever.
Right. Yeah. It was like you're on a race prototype.
Yeah.
Basically.
It's like blind taste test.
Blind taste test, exactly. Yeah. But that's how, that makes sense. But yeah, Neil, you know, after that ride was like, we were literally, and they had custom shaping as well. So they could turn up all of their like turn comp stuff. So as they're going uphill, they're just like, zooming uphill. And it was hard to put the genie back in the bottle after that. He's like, this is not like any other one wheel I've ever ridden.
Totally.
Well, let's see. One of the questions that I got on Instagram, which was an interesting one, was were there any things that any design elements that we like considered but we ended up not going with, or like did anything land on the cutting room floor? I haven't really considered that. Is there anything that exists that's like that?
Most of it made it in here, actually. Yeah. which is cool. I mean, that's not always how the development process goes. Sometimes you go on some side quest and barely make it back. But this one, that was part of the beauty of using or starting with a platform that we knew, right, with GT, and then, kind of honing in on what we wanted to improve. And, you know, we were able to base it off of, you know, some theoretical performance numbers based on what we should be able to achieve with the, you know, the powertrain updates. And then, the question is always like, okay, so if you can achieve that, you know, number of watts or that kind of power curve, like how does it ride? You know, like what does that actually mean? And then you find, oh, that means like, you know, you're like burning rubber when you're doing, you know, popping over a little curb or something like that, you know, which people are going to need to learn how to adjust their riding accordingly or like dial that back in custom shaping. But I think it's always that translation from like, sure, you have these specs in an engineering sense, but like, what does that really mean for riding? Right. And that's, I mean, you know that like more is going to be cool, but you don't quite know what it's going to unlock. And that's the exciting stuff for me, you know, like talking to the guys and they came back from that, you know, uphill flow trail ride, you know, raving about, you know, what it's like to hit berms on the way up, which, you know, you don't really do that on like a mountain bike either. Right. Like it's sort of, you now have like a inverted gravity sport where you get to like do gravity sport stuff going uphill, which is just pretty sweet.
Yeah, totally. What was the most challenging part of the like design process here? Or engineering?
Yeah, I mean,
aspect
in terms of the powertrain, just going to that voltage, which is kind of unusual. Like I said, it's not just garden variety stuff. Like, you know, that took a lot of searching and testing and, you know, getting it right to be able to, you know, support that, you know, develop new chargers that can, you know, charge the battery system at that kind of voltage and all that kind of thing. And, you know, push those boundaries. So yeah, that was definitely a challenge. But we got in here, foot pads, you know, I think foot pads, which may seem basic, but, you know, they're huge. Yeah. These are low boy foot pads started, you know, I mean, there was literally some like hand sanding of like, I want it to be like this, you know,
the famous Adam Laser shaping setting,
shaping some one wheel foot pads and, you know, just trying to create this, you know, Goldilocks of comfort and control, and also lower the ride height, you know, and people are like, well, how do you lower the ride height? Well, basically, you know, the pads are really low in the middle and they're, even proportionally lower on the edges compared to, you know, the GT concave foot pads. And they're way lower than the flat kick foot pads too.
And it makes it's pretty substantial. The cool thing is that they are available too for your stock GTs, right? So I think that's pretty cool that you know, if you want your stock, you're not ready to upgrade, you want your stock GT to have a more S-series feel to it, which I would highly recommend, you can buy those low boy foot pads and you can get that performance tire and have yourself an amazing riding experience.
Totally. Yeah. Those are big upgrades for GT.
Huge.
You know, if you got a GT, throw those on there.
Huge.
Yeah. It's going to feel good.
Totally. We were joking about this, the other day, but we were thinking about putting together the, I don't know if this is politically correct, but the poser pack bundle where you get your low boy foot pads, your performance tire and your GT S series rail guards. And no one else will know when you're riding out there except you. And when you're in the group ride and everyone else,
you get dropped.
Everyone else goes. But hey,
fun while it lasts.
It's a good, you know, it's almost there. But yeah, the foot pads are huge. And I think the other thing too, I mean, there's so much to talk about. It's actually hard to talk about it all. But the other fact that's pretty big is that it's 2 pounds lighter, and 2 pounds, it makes a big difference when the whole thing is like in the 35-pound range. 2 pounds is like a pretty significant chunk. I definitely notice it when I pick them up, throw them in the van. And I think, you know, the best riders, I'm not that good, but the best riders it's just a little more, you know, maneuverable. And we'll see if those bonk heights, those bonk heights, you know, increase a little bit here.
Yeah, I mean, it's lighter because the pack configuration is different, right? And the range is also a little bit less than GT, and we, you know, had to make that call of like, are we willing to give up a little bit of range for more performance and lighter weight? And we said, yes. You know, if you need maximum range, get a GT. But you know, this is about racing, and you know, that means like making certain compromises to, you know,
sure,
hit the target. You know, the the GT, you know, is a like 18S 2P cell configuration.
Okay.
So that means there's 36 cells okay. in it.
Okay.
You know, the S series is a 27S 1P cell configuration. So it has 3/4 as many cells, but each cell is upgraded from what they were on the GT. So we're using, you know, new cells from Molicel that are even more powerful per cell. And then because you have higher voltage, each cell actually, you know, doesn't need to put out as much current because you're achieving the power, you know, using the higher voltage. And so what all that means, first of all, the powertrain's badass. And second, most of that weight reduction is from the battery and of the board. So it's more balanced front to back, which is great too for, you know, tricks and trail riding and stuff like that.
Right. Yeah, no, that's super exciting. I think that'll be something that people enjoy once they get their feet under it. Let's see, price. $3,200, saw some reactions to the price. People saying, you know, that's too much. This is insane. My wife is going to kill me. You know, all of the comments on social media.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting, right? Because I think often I'm one who's saying like, you know, well, let's take that part out or let's, you know, figure out how to make it less expensive, you know? And from the beginning, like the vision has been to make one wheels approachable, right? And you know, obviously they're not like super cheap, but you know, most people, if they want to get a one wheel, they can, you know, they can save up some money, they can, you know, buy with financing, whatever. You know, now we have, you know, pretty extensive product line, right? From Pine to Pine X, GT, and now S series. So there's, you know, there's a lot of entry points to get in, but this one is really like the, you know, no compromises. Like, oh, we want to use, you know, NSK bearings. They're really expensive.
Yeah, sure.
Like, they're really good, you know, but they're really expensive, right? You know, the magnets are more expensive, the batteries, I mean, all these things are like basically the most ultimate that you can get. And we put all of them in here, you know, the power electronics to go to 113 volts because it's not like what's used in every e-bike or you know, power tools or something like that. It doesn't have the economies of scale. So this stuff is, you know, much, much more expensive, all the electronic components to you know, run at these higher voltages. So, you know, and then just obviously there's a lot of price increases across the board, you know, in terms of raw materials and inflation and all the stuff that's in the news all the time. So, you know, that's, if you're buying a new, you know, E mountain bike, like I wouldn't be surprised if it cost over $10,000. So, you know, it's just, you know, some people aren't going to understand, right? They're gonna be like $3,200 for what, you know, but if you're the kind of person who's like gung ho about this and like, you know, it is our target customer.
Right.
You understand like why this is $3,200.
I mean, that's my perspective on it, right? Is like, pick whatever your life hobby is, you know, the thing that brings you the most joy. For me, it's, you know, I love fly fishing. That's something that I grew up doing and it's like a passion of mine. I go on at least one trip a year to go fly fishing, as you know.
Always at the most inconvenient time.
Always at the most inconvenient time with no heads up. I'll spend too much money for myself to do that because that brings me so much joy and life happiness and experience. I look back at my camera phone. I'm like, man, remember when I caught that massive fish? That was epic. I don't think, oh, I dropped $2,000 to go fly to the middle of Wyoming to go, you know, whatever. And my fly fishing rod costs $1,500, even though I could have got the $300 one that will probably break next year. And whatever your hobby is, if you love it and it brings you so much joy, as your favorite hobby should, it should provide more for you than what you spend. And I think all the people that have one wheels and love their one wheels, they understand. Like, we see that all the time. First, it's the reaction. Like, I mean, we've seen this for years. $1,500 for a one wheel plus?
That, right?
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
And then you see, you know, 3 months later, oh my God, favorite thing I ever ordered. Bought two immediately afterwards. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's just kind of like the, it's the rhythm of life with like high-end consumer products, I think, right? And the same applies for if you love videography. Like, look, you can buy a pretty crappy camera for a couple $100, but if you love it and it's like something that's a part of your identity and brings you joy, like drop $3,000 and get a nice Sony A7S. Like if you love biking, same thing, you want a nice computer, you want like whatever, yeah, it is.
It's,
like,
it's hard to exactly put into words like what that additional benefit is,
right?
Right. You know, of going from like good to like really awesome.
Great.
Right.
Like the, no, not even great, like the best, is what we're talking
exactly.
about.
Exactly.
But I think like if you, here's the thing is like, if you love one wheels, if you love riding one wheels, this will be worth it. I can promise you, like, and you'll know it. Yeah. You'll know it immediately.
Right.
If you like kind of like one wheels, like, yeah, no, don't get this one. Like get a different one. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's value, and value is depends on what you, it depends on each person, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's less than $1,000 more than the GT, right? So you're basically going from GT as your baseline, you know, that price delta to get all these upgrades built in. And, you know, S series, like the concept behind the name, right, is, you know, it's like in cars, a lot of brands have, you know, Mercedes has AMG and BMW has M, you know, and it's like, those are the, you know, the factory upgraded models. And, you know, like a base model Mercedes or BMW is also super sick, you know, mm-hmm. but the, you know, the tuned ones, the factory upgraded ones, yeah, they start with a, you know, a familiar body style, and then they just like soup everything up, way up under the hood, right? You know, and that's what we did here, right? Like, I think some people are like, "Oh, did you just like push it harder? Like, is that why it's more power?" Like, no, we actually re-engineered all that stuff that's under the hood in this to actually be able to handle, you know, higher voltage, produce more power, you know, and produce the ride dynamics that this thing does.
So. And we have. Our factory team plus a couple special guests on the road, literally like starting yesterday, filming a new movie. Title remains to be seen. We'll see what it turns out to be, but we're already getting the cell phone clips that are coming through back today. And it's just like, holy smokes. Like it's just really cool and exciting.
Yeah. Don't see. Stand too close to the trail when those guys come by.
No.
You're getting rooster tailed. Yeah,
absolutely. So earlier today, I just, you know, threw up a story asking for some user questions. So we'll just do some rapid fire here based on those. Thanks for sending your questions, folks. Question from Cars Canoes Coffee.
Canadian?
Pretty killer combo. Have you dynoed the S series? If so, what are the stats?
Yes, we have dynoed the S series.
More or less than three times. what is a dyno?
Okay, what is a dyno? A dyno is something that's used for testing motors and powertrains, tests how powerful they are at what speeds, which basically means, you know, measuring how much torque, what speeds. So yeah, we spent a lot of time dynoing this. I can't give you the exact specifications, but I will say if you've seen that chart that is in some of the launch stuff, that's actual dyno data. Mm. So, I mean, that's not just like some lines we threw down. That's like actually, you know, what it is. So you can kind of see how much more torque there is at speed and, you know, to how much higher speed that the power band really, really goes.
Right. And of course the key sort of distinction on that chart that you'll see is that as you increase speed, the differences also increase, right? Which I think you bears out in the real world.
Exactly.
Question from Justin Mondina. How much experience do you think is required or best for the S series one wheel? I assume he's saying as a rider.
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, I think at low speeds, it handles more or less like a GT. I mean, if you put low boy foot pads and you put the performance treaded on your GT, it would be more or less the same at low speeds. It's not like it gets away on you or something, you know, in the way that, you know, like people are familiar with motorcycles or something, like, oh, should I get like a 1,000cc motorcycle or like a 250? And, you know, those bigger bikes, like, they do accelerate a lot faster. They are way heavier, you know, and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. This, I would say, like, in the sort of, you know, low speed range, it's basically a GT. Mm-hmm. It's really when you get to medium to high speeds where it, like, it just has a lot more to give.
Yeah.
So I would say, you know, anyone who's looking at a GT, you know, could look at this.
Totally.
You know, whether they're going to be comfortable and, you know, pushing it to its, you know, full potential, like, maybe not, but,
right. But if you're an inexperienced person, but you know that this is something that you want to jump into and you're going to really enjoy it, you're going to make it a part of your life. To your point, like, it's not harder than the GT.
Right.
I think it's actually, in some cases, you know, has some improvements that make it more stable and feel a little bit more in control. When you take into account the low foot pads and the softer durometer tire,
totally.
I gave my mother, Melissa, a demo yesterday in the parking lot, and, she gave it 2 thumbs up. She said, oh, this one's really easy.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's definitely not harder than any other product, that we make. It's just better. So, Max L Rose 919. Yo, Kyle D, what's your favorite one wheel Halloween costume of all time?
I'm glad we got to that. I don't know. I mean, there's a few classics, right? Like, I don't know. I like the classics. I like, you know, Aladdin.
Mm.
Aladdin on his magic carpet,
mm-hmm.
perhaps with his dog. Great.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right.
I think.
Oh yeah, what was
Land Speeder? Pretty amazing.
Iconic.
It's seemingly like someone takes it upon themselves to like push the limits of that every year.
Right.
You know, there's been a few, you know, people in, you know, a Jesus costume, you know, spreading
the
good news. So that's pretty classic too. So Goku, seen some Gokus.
Great.
Out there. So
to incorporate motion into your Halloween costume is really 3D. You
it
know?
Is. It is.
To incorporate the smooth motion of the one wheel is like.
I'm excited to see what people are, you know, doing this year. I saw a caveman riding his prototype one wheel. That was pretty cool.
Need that Fred Flintstone, like, soundtrack behind that. This is from MeHenv01. What's the symbol to the left of the headlights on my app? That's saying.
About to find out.
We'll check that out. We'll check in on that tomorrow.
Excited to put that little Easter egg in there for you.
What? is the controller updated to handle the higher voltage from Nathan O'Firth?
Yes. Controller is upgraded. The BMS is upgraded. The motor is upgraded. So everything's upgraded.
It's all upgraded. Would the new hypercharger work on a regular GT? From Justin Medina as well.
No, it does not. The chargers are different for S-Series because the voltage is 50% higher.
Mr. Ricky Nelson, any planned demos in SF? Would love to test one out. That's on me, huh? when those guys get back from this video shoot on the 8th, we'll have our crew back here and we can go do some local demos. Would love to. I'm going to send some notes out to some local group ride folks. Be really fun to show up to a group ride with a couple of these and let people rip around.
Yeah, I feel like I've spent a lot of time like talking about what it's like to ride this thing, but you can't really explain it. You have to try it.
You got to ride it. That's the thing. Yeah. I'm again so excited for everyone to hop on. Once you hop on, you don't want to go back to anything else. I've had the privilege of riding this all over the place, and it was so fun to go take this to some really cool places, and super fun to get these clips today too from factory team. Yeah, it's exciting to see
the first unboxings are happening.
The first unboxing, but I'm just excited to see what you know, how this sort of like pushes the sport forward. I know it's like kind of cliche and we talk about it all the time, but this is like an actual moment where things are going to get, you know, ramped up and in the awesomeness column by a By a lot. I mean, the difference, again, the difference in power that we're talking about is larger from GT to this. It's more sizable than the difference was from XR to GT, right? So, like...
Yeah, I mean, this is, like, the first time that we set out to build something that's performance-oriented, right? Yeah. Like, every product we made, there's, like, a rationale for it. This one is really about performance, which is exciting. And that's obviously, you know, like the racing side of it, like basically people, you know, have been taking like a product that wasn't particularly designed for racing and racing it, which is how racing always starts, you know, but then as it evolves, you know, you get more, race oriented and those lessons go back and they trickle down. I mean, our cars all benefit from, you know, stuff that was learned on the track and, you know, there's a lot of innovation that happens, out there. So yeah, that's what's baked into the S series.
Pretty exciting stuff. I guess my last question for you, we haven't talked about this yet on here, but, factory team. Brought on, 5 super talented one wheel riders, like the first sort of professional, full-time professional team. We just had a journalist here who works for the Inertia, which is like a surf publication, and Gear Junkie, and he's a big surf guy. And I was just telling him that, he's like mind blown that there is such a thing as professional one wheel riders. And I was showing him the cell phone clips, and he's like, "I get it. These guys are really
they're
good.
Really good."
But you know, how are you excited about that? What are your thoughts on the factory team?
I think it's awesome. I mean, you know, when I was first working on this stuff, like I dreamed of creating a new sport. Right. And obviously we've seen this sort of, you know, amateur, you know, racing basically develop. Right. And now it's developed to the point that there are a handful of people that, you know, make a living as pro one wheel riders. And I think that's awesome. Right. That's like the super next cool stage of the evolution. And, you know, we're really excited to work with them because, you know, they are, they're advanced and they push the limits and, they have a ton of great feedback and, they also share the stoke and, are ambassadors for this whole new thing that we're creating. Right. I think that's really, you know, what the sport element is about. You know, it's about like competition, but it's also about showcasing like what you can do on these things. Right.
And, totally.
You know, that is more and more, you know, as the riders, you know, gain more skills and new people get in and they bring skills they have from other sports and the hardware advances and, you know, we figure out how to build courses that showcase that. And, you know, it's kind of this like synergy of things all kind of moving up together.
Totally. One of the coolest things for me to see over the last 6 months is just how involved they've been, particularly, you know, a few in particular, in the creation of this thing too. Right. And I think this is like really, you know, we had a lot of people involved in the tire, which turned out amazing. We had a lot of people involved in custom shaping, which turned out amazing. And then this, you know, this is like, I'm sure you guys had started working on it a long time before, but this is like 6 months of just continually riding it, put it to the test, get the data, tweak it, make it better, you know, to this point. And I could not be more proud of how awesome it's turned out. I think it's no coincidence, right? That it's like where it is.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, we definitely had our hands full this year, you know.
Yeah. Like, how are you? Yeah, you've been busy.
You know, the CPSC stuff really kind of had us needing to like hold off on a lot of things we wanted to do, but now it's like, we're going to do those things.
We're doing all
like,
the things.
Boom, pro team, boom, S series. Like there's, you know, there's more stuff coming. Like, it's exciting.
Super exciting. Well, that seems like a good place to jump off. The one wheel S series is available right now on onewheel.com, $3,200. You can finance it for $110 a month. I would highly recommend if you have a friend that maybe ordered one and you haven't, go to their house and try it immediately. It's just incredible. It's really, really, it's pretty awesome. So, find a way to get on your feet on it. If you don't have one yet, put it on your wish list for Christmas. It's pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah, just stoked to get people riding on these things. It's a whole new world out there.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for tuning in, y'all. We'll see you on the next one.